somewhere out there in the vast nothingness of space. But tonight, on this small planet, on Earth, we're going to rock civilization.
Trans Resistor Radio.
You are listening to Trans Resistor Radio. I'm your host, Aaron Franz. My website is ageoftransitions.com. Please go to the website to subscribe to this podcast. You can do so using iTunes. You can use Stitcher Radio for mobile devices. And you can also just download every episode directly from ageoftransitions.com. Listen to them when you want. There's a plain old RSS feed there for you as well at ageoftransitions.com. So thank you very much for listening, for subscribing. Today on the show, I am continuing with my book notes series on the book Fire in the Minds of Men by James H. Billington. This is a book about revolution and the revolutionary faith specifically. So revolutionary France is really where it picks up. The book started there, so if you haven't listened to the first two previous episodes of this podcast where I got into my book notes here, you're going to want to go back and do so. And this would be the third installment of book notes from Fire in the Minds of Men, my personal notes room book, of which I do read some quotes from. And I'll just say that I'm doing this podcast for educational purposes here, and it's within the realm of fair use. So there are direct quotes in here. I'll be sure to mention when there are direct quotes from the book. Of course, those quotes are property of the respective copyright owners here, the author and the publisher. So let's just get back to it. I'm around page 250 now, so we're about halfway done with this book. So let's see how far we can get in this show. So let's get right into it. So page 255, I have this note saying that Barmby founded a propaganda society, the Universal Communitarian Society, I guess that'd be UCS, and also a journal, the Promethean, or Communitarian Apostle. Communism was to be the final religion of humanity. So, this political goal of communism was a religious practice to the revolutionaries themselves, and they used the Promethean term here. That's certainly a term from mythology, but has religious connotations to it. So the mixture of religion and politics is going on heavy here. I got into that in the last podcast quite a bit, too. Communitarianism is somewhat popular again today, and it came from out of, we're here in the 19th century now, here, Europe. So that's important to know. Another note, communitariums, communarchy, communarch, communist church. These are all terms used, I suppose. A new calendar and a vegetarian diet, communisteries. So this is the communitarian idealists. They want to institute all this stuff and use these words, make a new calendar, get people up on a vegetarian diet, and that sort of thing. Barmby, this is a quote from him, quote, "In the future, government politics will be succeeded by industrial administration," end quote. He was the first to say this. Okay, so he's calling for the technocracy. So communism and technocracy go together intimately, planned society, things like that, and they have since the infancy of communism and whatnot. Another note, 1848 to 51, Germans used highly religious themes to promote communism. This helped it appeal to the masses, because the masses are typically religious folk. Okay, European revolutionaries also fled to America. Okay, that was a safe haven for them to avoid persecution, apparently. It also, in the last show, they were going to Switzerland and things like that as well. Communism was labeled a new democracy, a way to fulfill democracy. Okay, how do you make democracy work? Well, communism, there you go. Marx, His first work in 1843 was a critique of Hegel's last work. Hegel had concept of universal class, yeah, leading humanity to an earthly millennium. Here's some religious ideas for you. Marx also used this idea. Okay, so yeah, the completely atheist materialist Marxist idea is actually tinged with this idea of this earthly millennium coming by way of a universal class. Okay, quote, world proletarian movement, end quote, would have English economic leaders and French political leaders. Okay, you got economics in France and politics in France and economics in England. Marx's ideology was, quote, a secular system of ideas based on a theory of history that ultimately promised answers for all human problems, end quote. So don't worry, all problems we got in this big system, we got all worked out. It's there on paper. It'll work fine. Okay, communism, quote, realized naturalism, which equals humanism, end quote. Okay, this idea of getting back to nature has been prevalent here too. Quote, the crucial new element that Marx brought to communism was dialectical materialism, end quote. The merger of Saint-Simonianism and Hegelianism. And if you don't know Saint-Simonianism or Saint Simon, I got into that in the last podcast. Very neglected historical figure brought to light here in this book. Very interesting. Got tons of interesting notes on the last podcast on Saint Simon. Quote, however religious in nature, Marx's ideology could never be religious in name. Ah, end quote. It was labeled as scientific instead. So it was a religious idea, but he could never admit to the fact. And the same stuff happens today. This is a topic that I like to get into, all these, quote, scientific things that are actually, in fact, perhaps more religious than they are scientific. And they claim vehemently to be the opposite, that they're anything but religion. They hate religion and anybody who subscribes to it. It's an interesting thing that Marx was very much into that same sort of deal. Let's see here. Idea that God was created by man because of man's material alienation. You know, how'd I get here? What's going on? I need to create a God. And that concept is popular here. Quote, Wittling argued that the time was ripe for revolution, which could be made in alliance with criminals and youth on the one hand, and with kings and princes on the other, end quote. Okay, all different, go through all different areas of society to get your revolutionary, different revolutionaries involved here. Marx and Engels associated with, quote, bourgeois Democrats rather than German workers, end quote, to get communism going. Okay, again, you gotta find whatever works best, basically. You know what I mean? You lip service to German workers, but you gotta get the bourgeois Democrats in on the project to get things going. League of the Just in London was working on ways to promote communism. Marx had little input there at first. He did not work with them. Next page of notes. League of the Just became the Communist League. Okay, change names. Marx saw cooperation with democratic parties essential. So in order to be effective, he needed to cooperate with these democratic parties. That's what Marx thought. Terms democracy and communism were interchangeable in 1848. Communism was more than socialism. It sought control over consumption, not just production, and was more materialistic in worldview. Quote, distaste bordering on revulsion for romantic sentimentality and a militant opposition to belief in God, end quote. Interesting. Communism was more associated with political violence. A belief in bringing about an egalitarian utopia free of violence justified a final act of violence to bring it about. So the ends justify the means, don't they? Small group of social revolutionaries, quote, that moved the social revolutionary camp toward communism, end quote, were literally homeless. Okay, so these real hardcore revolutionaries were homeless guys. They didn't have actual jobs. Their job was to be revolutionary. Let's see here. So Marx, quote, the Chinese Revolution will cause the explosion of the long-prepared general crisis, which, spreading abroad, will be closely followed by political revolutions on the continent. And Marx said that in 1853. Okay, so yeah, this idea of an inevitable breakdown of the system as is, in order that communism may come in and triumph over it. Okay, and this idea was long held in the Soviet system by the leaders there, and they continued to believe this in a very religious sense, like that the coming crisis is coming, and then that would be communism's time to take control, basically, and become the real world power when free market capitalism inevitably fails. Okay, 17th century, the term proletariat was first used. It was a derogatory label for lower classes, but in the 18th century, Rousseau used the term in a positive way. Okay, so this proletariat took on a whole new meaning due to the way that Rousseau ended up using it. Marx was arrested and had his journal suppressed. 1849, he changed his mind about opposing reconstitution of the Communist League. And I put a personal note, was his cooperation part of some sort of deal that we don't know about? Marx in 1850, quote, this is his quote, only when steeped in the blood of the June insurgents did the tricolor become transformed into the flag of the European Revolution, the red flag, end quote. Okay, so blood was in italics there, and blood red being the red flag of revolution. Enough of that tricolor stuff, let's make it even more simple. Billington makes a point that the revolutionaries are always looking for radical simplification, so why don't you just put one color on the flag, blood red. Blood red symbolizing a great many things. Yes. let's move on. Where are we? Marx believed that a revolutionary dictatorship was needed to act for the proletariat. Quote, overthrow all the privileged classes, the subjection of these classes to the dictatorship of the proletariat by sustaining the revolution in permanence until the realization of communism. More ends justify the means nonsense. Lots of that from Marx. Okay, dictatorship word was not seen as it is today. It was seen as needed to prevent counter-revolution. Okay, so dictatorship, the word, didn't have the negative connotation that it does today. This is just seen as another technique to use, to employ, in order to make sure that communism ultimately succeeds, so that, you know, you get the proletariat succeed themselves, because it's supposed to be all about them and freeing them and whatnot. Okay. Quote, the suggestion of Blanquist influence on Marx is anathema to later Marxists, who seem committed both to exaggerating Marx's originality and to caricaturing Blanquism. Okay, so hardcore Marxists would like to say that Marx came up with his ideas all on his own, and then more realistic people are like, hey, look, he had lots of French revolutionary ideas in there. What about that? And Marxists are like, no, no, no. And, you know, that's the way things go. We all... when you get these isms going and these movements going, the mythical figures who were the leaders or the originators of the idea are turned into these mythic heroes, and their real importance and significance and a lot of things they do becomes exaggerated for a great many reasons. That's just the way things go. Doesn't mean it's true, but that's what happens. Okay, so let's see here. Marx also took the phrase, quote, permanent revolution, end quote, from Blanqui. And again, I'm probably mispronouncing the name there, sorry. But permanent revolution was not Marx's term. Quote, the classical illuminist Bonarotian Blanquist type of conspiracy had taken root among Germans, end quote. The London Central Committee in charge of the Communist League. Okay, so we've got a conspiracy going on here, as is typical with these revolutionary moves. It's just how they operate. Willich, Weidemeyer, Wittling, and Marx immigrated to America. Marx was a writer for New York Tribune. Communist clubs set up in New York, Chicago, and Cincinnati, 1857 to 1858. Safe haven for him, America. Quote, Marx continued to believe in the inevitability of a social revolution, global in scope and permanent in nature. Okay, it's inevitable, it's going to happen, there's no stopping it. It's just a matter of when. Marx had many feuds with other social revolutionaries, Wittling and Proudhon being two prominent ones. So Marx versus Proudhon, this is a big battle here. Ideological showdown. Quote, a clash of the moralistic and the authoritarian temperaments over the question, should revolutionaries have an ideology? End quote. Marx would say yes to that question, and Proudhon would say no, that revolutionaries don't need an ideology. Proudhon was, quote, the ancestor, often unacknowledged, of anarchistic alternatives, end quote. So Proudhon is an early anarchist here, and it's not often acknowledged that he is. Okay, so Proudhon did not like authoritarian nature of Marx. Some people sure did, but he didn't. Okay, quote, Proudhonist opposition to centralism and ideological dogma. Don't like that stuff. Proudhonist idea of trade unions and co-ops not involved in political activity. That was his ideal. Marx, quote, his hero was Prometheus. Proudhon was not religious, but saw Christ as an example for true revolution. Instead of Sunday morning prayer, Hegel would read the newspaper. This wasn't common at the time. So for Hegel, reading the paper in the morning on Sunday was a religious activity. It was also an act of defiance to the church, which he didn't care for. Printing was central to revolutionaries. Quote, Louis Philippe's ministers saw a free press as the universal dissolvent, end quote. Okay, and I made the note there that that's alchemical language. No surprise. 1836. Two Paris papers sold at half price, quote, were designed less to instruct than to divert, end quote, and were actually the progenitor of, quote, modern mass journalism, which, to a large extent, is made to distract people. So, okay, this is interesting. These half-price papers in Paris, 1836, were made just to distract people. And Billington makes note that this is, yeah, this is a lot like modern journalism. Just stupid distractions. And veiled under the disguise that it's informing you somehow. Yeah, very, very interesting. Lots of ties back to the modern day here in this book. That's the best part about it, the little notes like this that link back to trends still ongoing today. Okay, quote, substituting entertainment for politics creating literary heroes in the absence of real political ones, end quote. And the readership exploded in this. Okay, so just giving people entertainment. They just make these heroes for... So, you know, they're being entertained. So they're not paying attention to what's actually happening in the world. They're living in the world of fiction. This became popular for people to do then. In 1830, pictures, cartoons, were first published in, quote, La Caricature, end quote. And then a new quote, men in the mass could often be reached through pictures more easily than through words. Through the common denominator of emotion, rather than the uncommon quality of reason. Okay, so give the normal guy some cartoons and some emotional funny stuff, and he'll be happy. Reason is uncommon quality here. Most people don't have it, or let alone exercise it. Okay, so 1845 to 1850, telegraph services were set up throughout Europe. It looks like it says here, throughout Europe, telegraph lines, making news sharing rapid. Quote, worldwide news network, end quote. It also, quote, increased police control at home. So increased communication, with that comes increased police control. And this is with extremely antiquated technology, not just the telegraph, but I think it's important to note the trend in the power of authority rising as communications rise, and how powerful a tool communication, all communications are to law enforcement and the like, and certainly setting up surveillance systems and things like that. Nothing new. Okay, the German Adolf Ludwig Fallen, quote, newspapers are the wind by which the weathercocks turn. And I put a note here, northeast, west, south equals news, the compass. And that's something I got from Jordan Maxwell, actually. He used to say that, you know, the compass is news. What's news? It's northeast, west, south. Those letters together spell out news. So I always found that kind of interesting. I think that there's something to that, to be quite honest. Corberon, I'm not sure if I'm reading that right, but anyway, it's a quote from him. Or wait, a quote from the book about him. He saw the production of a journal as a kind of Masonic initiation into a new type of fraternity, end quote. More masonry. It's been ongoing here in this book. 1849 to 51, typographers formed societies. They used the slogan, quote, toward the institution of a universal typographical Freemasonry, end quote. Interesting. So, typographers just worshiping typography and trying to get Freemasonry, specific typographical Freemasonry set up. I don't know. It's kind of funny. Okay. And again, journalism being very important revolutionary tool, that's the thing to remember here. It was used as a very important revolutionary tactic in many ways. Okay, so Russia in the 1860s, journalism was censored. Revolutionary journalism was suppressed. The Franco-Prussian War, 1870 to 71, New Journalism, New Napoleon, and Last French Revolution. It's the Paris Commune in 1871. Revolutionary nationalism died about that time, 1871. That had been the winning revolutionary trend. The nationalists were more prominent than the socialists up to this point. Now the socialists are coming to prominence on the revolutionary scene about this time, 1871. Bakunin became anarchist in later years, 1868 to 72. Garibaldi, an Italian national revolutionary, united North and South Italy in revolutionary victory. He set up a democratic association, which was quickly taken over by London-based International Working Men's Association, later called the First International, quote, dominated by Karl Marx. Okay, so they're trying to, looks like the socialists are trying to usurp what the nationalists did with their victories. I'm trying to commandeer that a bit. Mass journalism, quote, produced by working people, has almost always been non-ideological and only rarely revolutionary. Began in England and America. So this mass journalism stuff. Quote, the real weapon against workers from 1848 to 1914 was the new patriotic press. It hypnotized the masses everywhere, hitching the old romantic nationalism to the new wagon of industrial state power. Okay, press was a weapon against the workers. Interesting. England used the press to get support for Crimean War against Russia. The war was depicted as, quote, a kind of crusade for civilization, end quote. England, quote, this country is governed by the Times, end quote, paper in 1855. Okay, so the role of the Times of London there in England, very important. Quigley gets into detail about this subject as well. We'll learn more about this specifically. Okay, here is another quote. Quote, impulse to look for some universal secular transformation of society, end quote, came both from Napoleon and the revolutionary rhetoric. So both sides of the coin here were calling for this universal secular transformation. So it was going to happen one way or the other, wasn't it? Napoleon III, quote, transformed the Saint-Simonianism of his youth into an authoritarian industrialism, end quote, to strengthen the French state. In the same way, Bismarck took Hegelianism and turned it into a new German conservative nationalism. The old revolutionary Saint-Simonians and Hegelians gained influence in the establishment. Ah, yes, that's right, I forgot about this. So, let's see here. With Napoleon III and Bismarck, they came to power in their respective countries, and then they brought on the previous revolutionaries who had been the Hegelians and the Saint-Simonians, and those guys who were radicals became part of the establishment in so doing. That's interesting. Okay, Napoleon III co-opted the press. Quote, Napoleon simply adopted what his monitoring of public opinion convinced him was expedient, end quote. Okay, public relations is what he was doing. Co-opting the press. And he had been monitoring public opinion. Okay, so Rocafort's, quote, The Lantern, that's the name of his journal, was highly, highly critical of Napoleon III. Sorry, I couldn't read that for a second. My writing isn't the best. Even I can't read it sometimes. Okay, so The Lantern, highly critical of Napoleon III. He was forced to flee to Brussels, this Rocafort, I suppose, because he was so hard on Napoleon III. 1871, quote, the victory of reactionary somethingism over revolutionary nationalism. Chauvinism. Okay, the victory of reactionary chauvinism over revolutionary nationalism. I'm having trouble with my notes, aren't I? So chauvinism, okay, interesting. So, okay, anyway. In 1871, quote, the Paris Commune, oh, this is an interesting event, was the largest urban insurrection of the 19th century, end quote. New quote, last of the Paris-based revolutions, end quote. This Paris Commune was a final revolution in Paris before that whole, everything kind of lost steam. It was the end of French domination of revolution. Moved elsewhere after this. France was done with it after this event happened. Quote, mass defiance of the new military-industrial state, end quote. The Commune was an example for similar revolutions worldwide. Later on, it was a mythic event, turned into a mythic event. This was a tragic type event. Lots of civilians ended up getting killed in this event. I can't remember all the particulars, but let's see if I have that in my notes here. New, quote, emphasis on transnational social revolution, end quote. It's a turning point historically. Okay, the transnational social revolution became the new ideal at this time. And we're still hearing this today, still the big one. Big revolutionary idea there. Versailles troops came in and killed 20,000. Okay, here we go. Killed 20,000 people. They sent 13,000 to prison, or exile, on May 21st, 1871. The revolutionaries were viewed as criminals. Okay. The French government post-commune was the Third Republic. Quote, it wedded yesterday's revolutionary slogans, Republican government and secular education, to today's vested interests, end quote. The industry and the military were the vested interests. Okay, so this is the post-commune. They're just trying to appease everybody and try to get things working. And the whole commune thing was obviously a huge tragedy because the military came in and killed 20,000 people. Marx Bakunin ideology clash. Okay, so you got Marx and Bakunin. Their ideology clash after the commune. Both had been, quote, radical Hegelians, end quote, in Berlin. Both were internationalists. Bakunin was anti-authoritarian. His ideal was, quote, local autonomous communes, end quote, against all state power. He saw the need to get urban proletariat to work with rural peasantry to succeed. Yeah, okay. So you got Bakunin and you got Marx. Who's going to win this ideological duel here? Quote, a program of action which will overcome the individualism and conservatism of the peasants, end quote. Bakunin, an anarchist heir to Proudhon. Okay, so continuing on the anarchist ideas started by Proudhon there. Bakuninists introduced the term Marxist to the common vernacular, I guess. They introduced the term Marxist to condemn the Marxists. So it's a term of condemnation. Still is today. The International Congress was moved to New York by Marx. There's a feud between Marx and Bakunin, made social revolutionary tradition fizzle out in Europe in the 1870s because of this feud, and everybody, the whole thing just kind of fizzled out in the midst of the feud. Bakuninist, quote, propaganda of the deed, end quote, was violence. Okay, the Bakuninists were into starting violence. Romantic, heroic, emotional appeal of revolution lost after Paris Commune. Because it was so bad, the violence that happened to innocent people was so bad that the romance with doing violent deeds just, it was lost because the reality kind of set in at that point. Okay. Technique, militants, and violence became important, quote, modern mass warfare, end quote. Clouseret, a Frenchman, wrote about what happened with the Commune from a technical point of view. Lenin celebrated Clouseret's works. Quote, Germano-Russian period of revolutionary history, end quote, German equals social democracy, Russian was populism. Okay, during this Germano-Russian period of revolutionary history, the Germans had the social democracy and Russian idea was populism. Quote, light music for the masses, like the new mass journalism, provided diversion for reactionary imperialists rather than inspiration for revolutionary nationalists. Okay. Different strokes for different folks, as they say, right? Okay, Germany. Quote, the mysterious source of a golden ring capable of bringing mastery over the world and the downfall of the gods, end quote. And I made the note that this sounds like Tolkien and the Lord of the Rings fiction, obviously. And this is all happening in Germany, so... I don't know, important to make that note of a similarity there between fiction and reality. Wagner's music was highly influential politically. Again, music and theater being political tools. Very important subject to understand. Little understood subject, but one that I want to get more into. That it's something that interests me highly at the moment. Okay, so quote, imperialism proved to be a more effective rallying cry than revolution with the European masses. End quote. Europe conquering the world. That's what that's what the masses liked to hear about, I guess. That's what they wanted. That was what appealed to them. Quote, the machine, the machine is the magician of modernity. Okay, end quote, new quote, also became Moloch in motion, spreading the sovereignty of steel throughout the world. Okay, so the machine, the magician of modernity, also became Moloch in motion, spreading the sovereignty of steel throughout the world. Moloch is the large stone idol with which you sacrifice your children into a pit of fire. The pit of fire is the forge for steel. This is an occult phrase here, pieced together by Billington in a poetic way. As he does at his finest points throughout the book, he gets these poetic... he gets poetic here, and it's symbolic. And again, this machine coming to life and sacrificing things to it to bring about the sovereignty of steel and all this stuff... we see that theme in Lord of the Rings. So going back to a couple notes before, I mean, that certainly equates to this. Okay, quote, the subconscious model for revolutionary organization subtly changed from that of a structure to that of a machine. Subconscious model for revolutionary organization. It was a subtle change. It's no longer just this abstract kind of structure, it's particularly a machine. So we're building a machine, and the machine is the revolution. And this, I would also point out, as I was pointing out in the previous podcast, ties to transhumanism and sort of this rise of this ultimate machine being the ultimate end revolution, this eschatological event that brings about actually the dawn of a new humanity, the raising of humanity up to a higher level, all this complete, absolutely occult, lot of ties to the occult tradition in so many ways. And I don't know, just this is a very profound note, I think, right here. Good quote there. Okay, so Germany excelled in technological development. They became urbanized quite rapidly. Became a central power in Europe. Okay, so Germany is on the rise here about this time, the end of the 19th century. I'll hold off on talking about Germany too much right now, but Germany is an interesting place, interesting history there with Germany, and unique area to Europe. I know that Carol Quigley gets into Germany and its history quite a bit in the book, Tragedy and Hope. Yeah, I might do a Tragedy and Hope book notes someday, but he goes on about the Germans. But let's just save that for now. Let's just say that Germany's an interesting place. And certainly this book is showing us how a lot of occult ideas and inspiration for revolution, occult inspiration for revolution, came out of Germany, not France. Was taken to France. Okay, so trade unions were international, 1902 to 1903, international trade unions set up. We've got the Fabian Society, founded in 1883. Quote, rejected revolutionary tactics, end quote. Their emphasis was on gradualism. That was their technique. Gradualism was their method. So not a quick flash of fire. That wasn't their method. Theirs was, you know, the symbol of the turtle. Slow and steady wins the race. That's a Fabian slogan right there. And one has to wonder, I don't know if the Fabians actually coined slow and steady wins the race, but if they didn't coin it, they used it. Certainly fit into their whole scheme. And I've talked about how familiar slogans and phrases like that are. Incredibly, they almost always have huge occult significance to them, and this is a pretty good example of that. It would be slow and steady wins a race. Tying that to the symbol of the turtle in the Fabian Society would certainly be appropriate. Okay, so Bernstein saw Marx's idea of inevitable capitalist collapse and total social polarization as outdated ideas that needed revision. Wealth was actually spreading and class distinctions were blurring, as opposed to what Marx said would happen. This is the opposite of that. The idea that, quote, capitalist society might grow into socialism without a violent revolution, end quote. So, okay, there's no need for this revolutionary action. It's just capitalist society just kind of turn into socialism over time. One has to wonder if that has been, you know, the history of the 20th century. Is that what happened? Was that like really the true story going on there? We haven't, the history books haven't been written about it yet. Perhaps. One could certainly argue the case. Okay, so social democrats were different from French Masonic conspiracies. Masonry gave a separate place outside of politics to revolutionaries. The social democrats became vested within the political system. Ah, there you go. So Masonry is an outside organization, whereas the social democrats were just a group entrenched. They were within the political system. There's no separation whatsoever there. Russia had been, quote, renowned for reactionary nationalism, but revolutionary socialism came to succeed. Okay, they were typically nationalist, but the socialist experiment ended up working there. Revolutionary tradition, quote, was the bridge between Europe and Asia, end quote. Ah, so yeah, and we have the revolutionary tradition moving from out of France and from out of Europe into Russia at this point in history here, where we're at in the book, the turn of the century and all that. Explosives used by Russian revolutionaries. This was quite typical of them. They loved it, as Billington says that they really came to adore these explosives. November 1879, an attempt to assassinate Alexander V with a bomb by the People's Will was this group. Their name was the People's Will. The same group was successful in 1881. Used bombs specifically to create a powerful, lasting impression on people's minds. So the bomb, it's more about the psychological, long-term psychological effect on the public using the bomb than its actual direct explosive power and whatever damage it can do in that way. It's more about striking fear and intimidation into people's hearts and sending a message by doing that. So what's even more powerful, the realm of the mind. Again, we're talking about the occult tradition. The realm of the mind is where everything really happens. That's the idea. Typically, that's the idea. Russian tradition, 1860s, quote, nihilism, intelligentsia, populism, terrorism, anarchism. That's their tradition, okay, in the 1860s. Turbulent times. Student revolutionaries, many were at elite state schools. Oh boy, now I've got to pronounce a Russian name, so God help me. Chernyshevsky introduced scientism to students. Quote, absolute belief and scientistic nihilism. Okay, you got the nihilists and these scientists coming in. Just another form of religion, or anti-religion, which is actually a religion itself, so interesting to see how these things have continued throughout the 20th century and on into our day, too, in a big way. Okay, so Zeichnevsky's, quote, Young Russia book, quote, a revolution, a bloody and pitiless revolution, must change everything to the very roots. We know that rivers of blood will flow, and that perhaps even innocent victims will perish. Okay, well, again, the ends justify the means. We've seen quite a bit of that in today's podcast. Anti-human rhetoric among the students. Quote, man is a worm. End quote. So all this stuff reminds me of transhumanism, because the more extreme transhumanists will say things like this, and they mean it, and they're not afraid to say stuff like this. Also, eugenics ties into this, and similar sorts of ideologies. Eugenics was born out of scientism, social Darwinism, all this stuff. All the same sort of general mindsets seems to breed this sort of rhetoric. Okay, student revolutionary group, quote, the organization, that was their name, the organization, was led by a smaller subsect, which was called Hell. The subsect of the organization was called Hell. They had extreme vows of celibacy, secrecy, and separation from family. Intense planning for assassinations, and these guys were suicidal. So this sounds an extremist group of, within an extremist group that were planning assassinations. These were the most radical of revolutionaries and violent, and they were students. I would say that, I'll make a note here, that young men, young student men, are perfect candidates to exploit in this sort of way. If anybody's trying to get such violent revolutionaries to get them on board with you, I'd say that young men are prime candidates. They'll do this kind of stuff, and this is I don't know, this is a little truth of the dark side there. That's just how things work. Let's not go on to that. We're moving on. Nekayev went to Geneva, got accredited by Bakunin's, quote, World Revolutionary Union, end quote, and wrote a book, Catechism of a Revolutionary, quote, a continuation of Bakunin's efforts to adopt Masonic rituals for a revolutionary manual. Okay, so there is some Masonic influence, occult influence going on here at this time in Russia. That is a point of contention, or it has been, I know, when I've talked about these sorts of things with other people, but there's, I don't know, there's a little note to help convince people of the case here, that Freemasonry and occultism was in fact going on, at least to an extent, in the occult revolutionary tradition was still at work in Russia. Okay, so Nekayev became wanted internationally for a plot against the Tsar. He was in prison. He trained other revolutionary prisoners in disinformation while he was there. Ah, interesting. So he was still working when he was in prison, you know, like, keep the revolution going and teach people the tactic of disinformation. Important intelligence tactic, the most important one, arguably. Quote, An amoral elite must both make the revolution and rule after it, end quote. This is the method of the intelligentsia. An amoral elite. Oh my goodness. So we got elitist ideology going on here within revolution. Quote, populism tended to revive romantic faith either in a threatened culture or region. Okay, that's where it would take root, in that sort of place. The People's Will is a paramilitary organization. Quote, the structure represented an almost complete return to the Buonaradian tradition of secret hierarchical conspiracy, end quote. Led by an executive committee, or agent third degree. And I made a note here that the third degree is a master mason. So, Masonic roles here, Masonic positions given within these revolutionary groups. Gained much support from within, quote, ruling class government establishment. Okay, so these revolutionaries were given gained support within the ruling class. Quote, the ascetic terrorist sacrificing himself for a new era of freedom and science remained a model for Russian students. Okay, so yeah, they were terrorists. I was thinking of a terrorism earlier, but I prefer not to even talk about it, and if I can get away with it, but I mean, that's what they were. Okay, so Marx, on appeal of terrorism, quote, to shorten, to simplify, to concentrate the murderous death throes of the old society and the bloody birth pangs of the new. Oh, there we have birth pangs again. Where have we heard that before? Go back to the first podcast in this book note series, and I'll tell you how important that phrase is and how it's said over and over again. Here's Marx saying it again, and why terrorism has such an appeal. He's telling you the occult reasons for it. That's quite a quote there. Okay, I'll read again. To shorten, to simplify, to concentrate the murderous death throes of the old society and the bloody birth pangs of the new. So the death, the violent death of the old, and the bloody birth of the new. And thus you have the red flag being the color of revolution. The standard of revolution, the banner of revolution being just the plain red flag here. Now, this was all part of the idea, death and rebirth business. Marx on appeal of terrorism, quote, to shorten to... Oh, wait, sorry, I just read that. I mean, I'm a little off here, but sorry. Please bear with me. I hope that you are. Anyway, next note. Lenin's older brother, Alexander Ulyanov, helped form new terrorist fraction of the People's Will in 1886. Quote, the power of the mask, end quote, revolutionaries began wearing masks. This is a rather Dionysian sort of thing going on here. A rather dramatic sort of stage play sort of idea going on here, but I'll digress. Okay, quote, the revolutionary mask destroyed all links with the familiar and predictable, all loyalty and accountability to normal human society, end quote. So in other terms, you're anonymous when you're wearing a mask. And we have the revolutionary group today called Anonymous, who, when they're out in public, or at least the representatives of the group, they wear masks, right? The Guy Fawkes mask. So it's a revolutionary, it helps the revolution. This gets into so much deep stuff that I need to write about. I'll say that I am working on a large project about all of this at the moment. I have no idea when I'll be able to finish it because I'm very busy at the moment, but very deep subject matter here. Masks, again, Dionysus, the god of drunken revelry, and the god of the vine, sort of the spirits, the alcoholic spirits taking over the individual personality, drawing away inhibitions from it in order that it may be animated for a greater purpose. Things like this. That's what's going on. And the tradition of the past, the revolutionary tradition of the past, leading up to the anonymous group of today and their mask wearing and all their nonsense that they do. I'm not a big fan of anonymous. Okay. The term anarchism became popular in the West at precisely the time when Russian revolutionaries were tending to abandon it in favor of terrorism. Okay. So anarchism wasn't enough. It's time for action. Let's just terrorize everything. Let's get violent. This is something to look out for in our day. Western anarchists encouraged assassinations and violence. Okay, the Western anarchists. Kropotkin was a Russian, went to Western Europe, and became most influential anarchist. His focus was on setting up small communal groups, return to simple life. He had a Proudhon was an influence on him. Quote, revolutionary syndicalism, a linking of trade union organization with mass action aimed at the creation of a new social order, end quote. Ignore politics. It was biggest in France, Italy, England, and the U.S. The economic depression, mid-1870s, Europe, that was going on. Labor strikes used for revolutionary purpose. 1904, quote, general strike, end quote, in Italy. 1 million plus workers were involved. Other general strikes in 1911 and 1914 were anti-war. Quote, in agitating for Italian intervention, syndicalists helped form bands, fasci, for revolutionary action, end quote. No, the quote continues, I'm sorry. They represented war and revolution as parts of one ennobling process, end quote. Okay, so that symbol of the fasci, the bundle of sticks tied together, was used to represent revolutionary action. Again, different parts coming together for one larger purpose. Quote, Mussolini was literally baptized into the revolutionary tradition, end quote. His father was a radical blacksmith. Mussolini, a revolutionary here. Both Mussolini and Lenin edited revolutionary journals with titles that mean forward. Forward. Forward sounds a lot like the word progressive. Has a revolutionary tinge to it, all that same, or that word. So with that, I'll end reading my note. I want to thank everybody who sent me donations. I've got some generous donations recently. Anybody who buys my book, Revolve Man's Scientific Rise to Godhood, that's a great way to support me. It means a lot to me. I'm hoping to have another book for you here soon. As I was saying about Dionysus and the God of the Mask and all that kind of business, I want to write a book about that in detail. There's so much. That's an incredible subject that I really feel the need to write a book about. So that's a project I'm working on, something to look forward to. Again, I have no idea when I'll actually be able to get done, but I'm going to do my best to do so.